Right. When you install the software, you should be able to find out that from here. If you search IHS, and you can see that that's the IHS Harmony here, 2016. So open the software now.
This is almost open here, man.
But now you click on the new project and so from this, let's say, interface, you don't need to work on anything except basically here that you just create a well and then start with the analysis. So forget about the rest of the options here. So if you click on this button, it asks if you want to model a kind of gas or, for example, oil or, let's say, CBM, like the coal bed methane reservoir. We are interested in the oil reservoir. As you have read through the coursework, you can see that this is about the kind of, I think, oil field in the beach bar, right? So now I select the flowing option here because that's about a producer rather than, for example, any kind of injector or, let's say, a storage or abundant, for example, section. So click on the flowing here, and by clicking that, you can see that it's generated the well, for example, 01. That means you've got one oil producer now to model it for the first step, for the next step. So you have some tabs here, and you only basically work on the analysis tab here. If you click on the analysis now, it says that double click on any entity in the entity viewer, that basically means here. So if you have done, let's say, some well bore, let's say, creation here, you just click on this one. And then it gives you a number of the analysis that you've got in the IHS Harmony. So again, we've got a Dicron Plus, RTA, CBM, and also Virtuewell. And this is the only one that we need to work for this course, because that's about TPC and IPR, or let's say nodal analysis. So click on this now. And now you need to put your data from this step into basically this section. When you click on the oil IPR TPC, you can see that it's generating a blank plot for the pressure and rates. So it's waiting for you to put the data inside the software, and then it come up with the IPR and TPR curve at the end. So if now you look at the tab just beside to the oil IPR and TPC, that's about the editors. And editors, if you just click on the editors, is the main tab basically for putting all the information that you've got in this coursework. So basically from table 1 to table 6, somehow also table 7, you need to take these data and put them in different sections here. In the editor, you have some tabs here, you can see. But the only one that you need to put your data, and you have the data for them, is the properties and wellbore section. In the properties, you put your PVT data, and you can see that's about the properties, right? And if you click then on the wellbore, you put the wellbore data. So we start with the PVT or properties here, and you can see that here you've got different let's say, phases for the fluid. So what software asks you, what sort of phases is basically involved in your model, select these phases and give me the properties for these phases, right? So because that's a kind of oil producer, the main phase is the oil. We know that we may have, for example, sometimes water production from the wellbore, and also gas when, for example, we are going below the bubble point pressure. And if you look at your table one, that's about all PVT properties that you have for this coursework. So we start with the gas now. If you click on the gas, in the next tab here, you need to put some information here for these properties. The only property that you have from the table is the gas specific gravity. So just click here. This is the gas property, and this is, for example, the G. If you click here, you can update your value, for example, by putting how much point A to here. And then click accept. And you can see that it is updated with your new value. If you don't have any other value from the coursework, you just leave all the other values as default here. You don't need to change the any other parameters here. So that was only for the gas property here. Click on the next one, which is oil condensate. So that means you now put the properties for the oil. Again, for the oil property, what you have again from the table, you have oil gravity, and you have, let's say, the bubble point pressure as it is basically required here. If you see that this is something, for example, red and red here, that means these are required for you to have the model at the end. So the oil specific gravity is somehow 38, let's say, PI. So updated to 38, click accept, and the bottom, the bubble point pressure is 1700 here. Now click accept, and make sure that basically you have the right values for this parameter here, because you can change it if you just click. Right click on the parameter, on the unit, you can choose any other, let's say, units for this parameter. So that was for the oil. And let's go to the water now. For the water, you have water specific gravity and salinity, but you only have the water specific gravity. So you just need to put here and then put 1.1. for the water specific gravity. You don't have any value for salinity, so just leave it as default, zero here. So these are about the fluid properties, but you need to put some reservoir properties here. And the only value that you need to do here basically is about the table two, which is the reservoir conditions. So you have the reservoir pressure and you have the reservoir temperature. So the reservoir pressure is 3800. So you can see that now these plots have changed because the software is going to use this initial point as the pressure and temperature, and those properties to basically calculate or plot the PVT properties for you. And the next one, which is the temperature here, it's about 187 degrees. And when you click, you can see that these are the generated plots for you. So if you have done the PVT section correctly, you should get some plots at the end in the right hand section here. And if you go, for example, to the gas now, you have the properties plot for the gas and for the oil as well. You don't need to put any other values here because for this course and for the purpose of the what basically you want to do with the model at the end, you don't need to put these values here. So that was for the section properties, and now you are happy with this section, and you go for the wellbore section. So in the wellbore section, which is the last section of the editor that you need to work on, and which is a bit now more work for you, you need to put three basically set up the data here. One for the profile, one for the temperature, and one for the deviation survey. So in the profile, you give us the casing data, what sort of, let's say, completion you have. In the temperature, you give us the data of the temperature versus depths. And finally, the deviation survey, that's about the, let's say, well path, true vertical depths versus the measured depths of the well. So let's start with the profile here. And for the casing data, if you go to the table number 5, you have the information for casing one. So the casing one, let's say you've got a production casing here. So that is from the top, and the bottom of the casing is 8.5. 25 from again the coursework, and the inner diameter is 6.4, and the roughness is 0.0012. So you can see that after putting this value, the software is creating a kind of production casing from the top to the bottom of the well. The next one is about the tubing data here, and if you go to the table number 4, you've got three kinds of tubing in your coursework. So the first tubing, the bottom of the first tubing is 3460. The outer or the inner diameter is 4 inch. The outer diameter is 4.5. And you have the same roughness. The next tubing is at the bottom of the 5000. So just look at the picture again, that is changing in terms of the tubing inside the casing now. So the inner diameter is now 3. The outer diameter is 3.5 with the 0.0012 roughness, and the last one is at the depth of the 7000 with the diameter inner of 2.441 and the outer one 2.875. So this is now about the roughness, and then you need to put the perforation intervals now, and that's from the table 3. We know that the top depth for the perforation is 84, 75 feet, and the bottom one is 85, 25 feet here. So the flow proportion here means that what is the percentage of the, let's say, perforation here in this interval. You just put it as 100, which means that you, assuming that you have fully perforated your perforation here. And now you can see that your datum measurements basically is 8500, which is exactly between this one and this one. So this, the software is assuming this datum depth for the later on solution node in the nodal analysis, right? And this is a kind of, let's say, a schematic of the wellbore now you have. You have the casing now, three types of the tubing, and finally, your perforation, for example, which is the red one here. Now let's go to the temperature one. You can put a linear profile temperature or detailed profile, but we have only the linear one, because from the table number 7, you have the wellhead temperature at zero measured depth. So measured depth is equal to zero. That means basically your top of the well. So the 166 is your wellhead temperature, and the sand phase temperature, which is exactly at 8500, which is again kind of the solution note for you, that's 187 Fahrenheit. So that's about this section. And you go to the next section, which is about the deviation survey of the well. In the deviation survey, if you go to the table number 6, that's about the deviation survey again. And you've got the different values for the measured depths and true vertical depths in your deviation survey. So the first one is 0. And 0, so that's the first point. The next one is 3460, and that's 3163. So you can see that now the software is trying to give you the direction, or let's say the deviation of the well, as you're updating the values in this table. So the next one is 5000 at 4500 TBD. The next one is 7,000 at
6,100.
The next one is 8,500.
7,500.
And this is the final, let's say, schematic of the well bore here. So now you have done everything in terms of putting the required data to model, let's say, the well bore and then the reservoir at the end. If you have done this correctly, you should not get any errors in the red color here. So if this is blank, that means you are now in a, let's say, safe side, and you can go for the analysis now. So by completing the properties and well bore section, we should be able to go to the tab, or let's say analysis tab here, and do your basically nodal analysis here. So what you basically do now, create one IPR and one TPR, and then look at the intersection point, how much is, for example, your production from the IPR and TPR. Okay, to create any IPR or TPR, if you go to the analysis manager here and then click on this button, it says that either you want to have the oil deliverability Vogel, for example, plot, or tubing performance curve. Let's start with the deliverability using the Vogel correlation. So if you click on that, you have some, let's say, boxes here that needs to be completed here. So what I can do here is basically I have my average reservoir pressure here, which is sorry, 3800. This is my bubble point pressure, which software basically is taken from the previous section properties when I put the value there. But I need to put one PWF and one Q oil here. And how should I do that? The thing is, in your coursework data in table number 3, you will have some information for the inflow parameters, like oil productivity index, IPR model, and water cut. You can see here that you need to put, for example, the value of the Q oil and PWF here. So the easiest way for you to do that is basically use this equation now and come up with two values for the oil and oil rate and, let's say, bottom oil pressure. So if I say this is my equation for the case that I am above the bubble point pressure, I know that J is equal to 2.9 for the oil, let's say, and I know that my reservoir pressure is 3800 psi. So I can use this equation to have one, let's say, point for the Q oil and PWL. So because it's about above the bubble point, you can choose any other pressure above the bubble point. So in your case, the bubble point is about 1700. So between 1700 to 3800, choose any, for example, bottom hole pressure. Let's say I have choose the 3500 here, right? So then I say that my oil rate is J, for example, 2.9 times 38 minus this value, and I got 3300 times 870 now for the SDV per day. So this is my value for the bottom hole pressure, and this is for the rates. You may have the other value depending on your basically selected bottom hole pressure. It doesn't matter which value, as long as you are between 1700 and 3800. So going back to the software now, I put my bottom hole pressure, for example, at 3500. And then rates of 870 here. And then by clicking on that, let's say when you finish with this option, you should have a kind of a straight, let's say the IPR curve from the software. So now I want to do the TPR and then look at my dissection point after that. So for the TPR again, you click on the button here, and now you choose the tubing performance curve. So you can see that beside to the analysis one, which was the IPR, you now have the TPR. And for the TPR, you know, basically you somehow need to put some data here. The first one is the wellhead pressure, which came from table number 7. You've got the pressure at zero measured depths. So that's basically your wellhead pressure. You put 220 here. The GOR is from PVT properties, which was 400 SCF per STB. You can see that when you update the values, the software gives you basically the TPR curve. And the final parameter here is WOR, which is the water oil ratio. And that's basically barrels per STB. How you can get this value? Okay, how I can get this value? If you look at the coursework, it says that the well is producing at this much liquid rates at the standard, let's say, conditions, right? So when you want to calculate the water oil ratio, we need to somehow water rate and then divide it by the oil. And that's basically in the unit of barrel per STB. You have the water cut from the system, from the cursor here, and the water cut is about 1700, right? Sorry, 17%. So the water cut means that your, let's say, Q of water divided by Q oil plus Q water here. So you have the water cut, which is 0.17 from the coursework, you have this, basically you want to calculate your water production. The total liquid production is this much. So if you now multiply this one together, so that's in STB per day. So basically, that's your water rate. And the oil rate would be the total production minus 901, which is how much? 40?
49.
So that's the oil production and that's the water production. Now I can have this parameter here, but be careful here because this is in barrel and this is per estimate, right? So your water oil ratio is equal to the water rate, for example, this one. 901, but we need to somehow convert that into the barrel. So that's why basically you can use the BW here, but we assume the BW is equal to 1 most of the time. So that's why we can assume that this is nearly like 901 here. And the oil rate is 4399. And how much is this ratio? Half. Anyone has calculated it before? Zero? 0.05.
0.05.
Right,
2.0. Okay, let's say this is nearly 20%. So now you go back to your model and put this value here. And then this is your final, let's say, point of the intersection point here. You can see that the software has used basically the wellbore configuration here as the physical wellbore that you have defined previously in the properties, in the wellbore section. So if you want to know that you have done correctly the base model, you need to check your operating point from the software here. This is basically how much you have at the end for the operating point, and this is how much you have for the bottom wall pressure. So this is the resulting from the model, from the software. You just try to simulate your wellbore based on the, let's say, field data. And the field data was how much for the oil rate? How much? Because this value was coming from the data, from the field data, as you can see in the table, above the table 7, it says that the well test survey indicates that the liquid rate of 5,300 STD per day at the bottom wall pressure of 2,281 PSI. For the bottom wall pressure. So now you need to look at your values here and the values here. How much they are different? somehow nearly, let's say, 60 barrels, right? So that's the error that you've got from the software. So you may not get the exact match between your data and the simulation, but in this case, the 60, let's say, STP per day is somehow appreciable. We basically accept it as a kind of, let's say, a good match between my, let's say, software simulated and, let's say, my production data. So if you have done the modeling correctly, you should get some value or this value close to this one, not a very like high or very small value for the Q oil when you compare it with this one. And that's basically for all part A. In part A, I want basically you to calculate, or let's say come up somehow with this one. You basically model this one and submit the model as part of the coursework, and then answer the part B and C based on basically what you have done here today. So that was for part A. For part B, I just go through the test well model next week. Just basically do what we basically you need to do in part B on the test well model. So I won't work any more on this model because that's the model that we submitted for the first one. But make sure that you've got something like this in this model, not something very
just make sure you've got the answer.